we're about to get started with our next presentation as well. In fact, a very interesting topic awaits us. But before that, let me also set a little premise for the topic. Now, we all know the famous actress Marilyn Monroe, and she very famously said, "I don't know who invented high heels, but all women owe him a lot." Now, here's the thing, the beauty in design is not just restricted to skyscrapers, or for that matter, spaces. It is spread across a gamut of objects and things that actually make us marvel. Now, did you actually know that in the 1950s, the stilettos were actually known as skyscrapers? So what is that one common thing between skyscrapers and stilettos? It is the science of design. And which is why our next speaker will be sharing her presentation on architecture in stilettos. All the women, I know you're all smiling there. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to invite on stage Ms. Natasha Kochhar from LTDF Architecture and Design, New Delhi. Let's have a huge round of cheer and let's gear up for a very interesting presentation on architecture in stilettos.
Hi everyone, I'm Natasha and I'm here to present a subject which I'm sure has a lot of question marks, the architect in stilettos. So it's not a speech on gender bias, it's not a speech on any design inspirations, it's a speech on something very simple. I'm here to highlight to everybody a subtle difference which sometimes is missed, the difference between being specific and being stereotyped. So from the point of view of a woman designer in the Indian design and build industry, I feel our profession, especially the interior design profession, is often stereotyped for women. So if you see this Google search image, when we search architect, you see just the word architect, we have an image search, we see men. However, when we go interior designer, you see more women. So now, why stiletto? Stilettos are worn by women, as was just highlighted, as a fashion choice. At least in today's day and age, it's a choice which is specific to women. This has perhaps a logical perspective in the sense men don't choose to wear it. A stiletto is specific to women. However, architecture at the moment is being very stereotyped towards men. Now, while Zaha Hadid leaps to mind as a rare female architect, as a rare female architect in the field of interiors, has had a lot of famous women designers. As many of you would know already, the world's first interior designer was actually a woman, Divulge from USA. So she's the one who invented the profession of interior design, and at that moment it was called interior decoration. However, after the World War II, the men entered this profession in larger numbers, deeming it as serious and lucrative, and that is how interior design became man-made. Today, it is more man-made than woman-made, even though there are actually more women doing interior design in the industry. However, the top firms happen to be all men at the moment. Now, coming to specificity, if we look at the macro level, in the 1990s, a simple survey in Vienna led urban planners to rethink their whole approach to infrastructure development. The questionnaire asked residents why and how they use public transportation, and the results were striking because men and women had very different responses. Men's typical route was short and simple, often to and from work. However, women's responses were complex and varied, usually including multiple trips a day on the metro, as well as on foot, dropping off children at school, going to the doctor, getting groceries, visiting older people, back to school for pickup. This prompted a moment of realization for Vienna's planners. Infrastructure has a gender aspect to it. Women and men have different needs and uses for public structures and systems. As a result, they planned the transportation projects based on women's needs. Now, I think in India in general, the public and the urban sector does have a lot of women-centric issues covered. However, when we go on the micro scale, when we come to interior design, because that is my work and my arena of expertise, we all go to hotels. A lot of us travel a lot, we go to hotels. In how many hotels have you gone and in the bathroom have you seen next to the mirror there's a shaver point? Now, it's a shaver-only point. However, women need straighteners, women need gadgets, you need things. However, but this norm was set for men, by men, perhaps because it's become man-made. So what I feel is women need to take the forefront as designers and as users. And the whole design environment needs to be more specific to usage than stereotypical. Let's go to some more stereotypes, which may work towards men and women. So this is a basic understanding of the size differences that occur in usage of men and women. Now, something as small as you go to a hotel, general shower, the shower heads are placed at 7 feet, which is unreachable for a lot of women. However, these are norms, these are standards set by men. So something, again, I'm focusing on gender here because, again, that's something very easy to highlight at the moment. So any 20th century woman can vouch for a few of the inconveniences at some point. Cobblestone or gravel in restaurants, women need to have heels. Women wear saris, however, most hotels do not provide for full-length mirrors. No-hand showers, which are a problem. Can a space be defined masculine or feminine in just the aesthetic sensibility? We spoke about the functionality, now we're going to speak about aesthetics. We've occasionally been known to design spaces which follow stereotypes. Of course, calling something masculine or feminine does not mean that a particular room is only for a man or a woman. It means the space is being described based on the qualities we associate more with one gender than the other. But why do certain aspects of decor make us think masculine or feminine? And is following this a helpful way of getting a handle on a certain look or perpetuating the image of damaging stereotypes? Let's take an example with some images just to go through this. Now, if you see this living room, there's a lot happening there. There's a lot of fur, there's pink, there's florals, all of that. So this makes it read very feminine. It's a neutral room, however, there's a delicate tray and a tufted headboard. But the florals still swing more towards feminine than masculine. The furniture here is very, very simple. However, the flowers and the pink walls again steer us towards thinking of a feminine space. Now, this is blue, which is typically a masculine color, but because it's light, it's pastel, there's florals, it's softer in its basic imagery. So again, it steers towards feminine. Ruffled pillows add that little feminine angle in this space. Again, soft pinks, blues, pastels, feminine. Now we go towards the masculine. Now we see a leather sofa, dark colors. Instantly, everyone's reminded of something masculine. Nothing more masculine or a bachelor's pad like a Corbusier black leather chair. Plaid prints, check prints, wooden headboards, masculine. Heavy interiors, dark colors, wooden ceilings, masculine. A lot of leather with deep blues, royal colors, again steering towards the masculine. So there's a few things that define gender in design, but what the need for today is basically that it's not, these associations are made by our exposure and our stereotypes, whether it's exposure from fashion, whether it's exposure from lifestyle, or from anything. What one needs to do is basically imbibe the aesthetics of the space based on the requirement of a client, which we all do. However, stereotype application must be changed. We must not apply stereotypes based on why something looks masculine or why something looks feminine. It should be based on what the person wants. Gender design elements and stereotyping, shrink it or pink it philosophy for women doesn't work anymore. What is needed is to understand women as a user in every aspect of interior design and architecture, and not generalize what men want as a norm. This debate of specificity and stereotyping must also be applied across all biases. We as designers must move forward and rethink stereotypes, as the theme of this festival is reimagine. The idea is to reimagine what's done in a new way, not how it's already done. So for example, I mean, going to interior design again, a Marwari or a Punjabi home does not need to have a lot of gold. Maybe their family structure should get more focused than just the look. Or a foreigner may not always want a modern interior. Or a girl's room does not need to be pink. I mean, it can have a black and white chevron today. So let's reimagine the given and redefine the way we design sometimes without the stereotypes that we've grown up with. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Natasha.